Thank you, Lord. Thank you for looking down in Tulsa, Oklahoma and finding a little stuttering boy that when nobody knew I was gonna be anybody, you had favor on me. When my grades wasn't good, you had favor on me. When I was misbehaving, you had favor on me. When folks was cussing me out and cursing my life, you had favor on me. When they thought the end of my life was gonna come, God had favor on me. That's why I can smile, that's why I can shout, that's why I can praise him in spite of whatever, because I know where I came from. Is there anybody here know what I'm talking about? When you know where you came from, when you know what God brought you out of, when you know what God brought you through, it doesn't matter what's going on right now, you know your Redeemer liveth, and you know that God's hand. Thank you, Lord. Send with me if you can. Send with me if you can. Send with me if you can. Philippians chapter 3. Praise God for the young adult choir singing this morning. Amen. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10 and 11. There you find these words recorded. Paul says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may obtain to the resurrection from the dead. If you don't mind, I want to preach from this thought or this theme, the main goal of outreach. The main goal of outreach. You can take a seat. If there is one thing that has crippled the church, it is that we do not understand the real goal of outreach. I'm a firm believer that if we understood the real goal of outreach, we might do it more. Help me, somebody. If we understood the goal of outreach, we might not do it for the wrong reasons. So God thought it would be good with our souls if I preached from this thought on my way to heaven, the main goal of outreach. First of all, stop trying to feel good. Some of us only go out to reach the lost to make ourselves feel good. Some of us have been so hellish in our life that we think now we got to make up for all the hell that we caused. But I need to tell somebody, you can't make up for all the hell that you caused. That's why Christ had to go to Calvary. If you could make up for the hell you caused, he wouldn't have died on an old rugged cross. But he understood that I could not make up for all the hell, all the pain, all the tears, all the heartache, all the late nights I caused my mama and daddy and grandma to stay up, walk in the house, trying to wonder where I am, what I was doing, who I was with, what did I say? Is there anybody in here that ever caused anybody any pain in their life? Maybe you're better than the rest of us, but there's some real folk up in here that you know some of them wrinkles on mama's face was caused by you. Some of them gray hairs in her head had your name on it. Some of that pain that she had in her face had your name on it. But the good news is God put such a love in her that she loved me in spite of myself. And now that I know better, now that I do better, I cannot do it just to make me feel good. You know how it is when you want to feel good, you try to find somebody that look like they at their lowest point. Hello, somebody. We then take the Bible out of context, and that's when we try to run up with a word. Amen. Just because we feel good. Some of y'all got the big chest witness ministry. You witness only when your chest gets big. Help me up in here. But how many of you know that real witnessing, sometimes you don't feel good? Real outreach, sometimes ain't nobody gonna pat you on the back. Real outreach, sometimes you can send the word and not even see evidence of the word being received. Let me talk to some real folk. You ever pray for your grandchild and they still act stupid? Let me help somebody else out. You ever go take care of your kids and they still act crazy? You ever pray on them, put oil on them, and they still act like they done lost their mind? Why? Because it's not for me to see all the evidence of my ministry. It's that the Lord will get the glory. And so when I understand that, I try not to feel good. I just try to do what the Lord told me to do. In fact, let me help you. Real outreach doesn't feel good at all. Because real outreach is not in and of myself. I gotta sacrifice me to do real outreach. Help me somebody. I gotta go places I don't wanna go. I gotta talk to folk I don't wanna talk to. I gotta love folk I really don't really like. And that's what real outreach is. So stop trying to feel good. Secondly, stop trying to look good. Some of you do outreach only when the cameras are on. Hey man, I'm a witness when I got a crowd because I want them to see me in action. I'm going to share the gospel, but I want to make sure there's witnesses around so they can go tell the church folk how good of a Christian that I am. So you got to stop trying to look good, because the reality is that true outreach isn't about how you look. It's about what you point to. Y'all missed that. You see, as long as I'm trying to look good, I'm pointing at myself. But real outreach is not looking at me. It's pointing to Christ. It's Christ that saves. It's Christ that changes. Stop trying to look good. Some of y'all won't witness because you can't get your speech together. Reverend, when I get my speech together, that it rolls off my tongue, then I'm going to witness. But right now, it don't sound good when I practice in the mirror. But real outreach is not about how smooth you sound, but it's about the power of the words coming out of your mouth. Y'all help me, somebody up in here. It's not how smooth and how eloquent and how intelligent you sound. In fact, let me help you. God used an ass to get one of the most powerful messages in the Bible, which was stop. There's an angel right ahead of us, ready to kill you, fool, and me. In Bible country, y'all do remember that, don't y'all? So if God will use an ass to preach the word, it didn't say that the ass had perfect English. It didn't say he changed his dialect, but he had the warning that was needed for the man of God on his back. How many times have you missed giving somebody the warning because you worried about how it's going to sound? Oh, we ain't getting a whole lot of amens today. Some of y'all done ducked your head. Don't act like you praying. Don't make me discern you up in here. Stop trying to look good. In fact, get out of your mind that the only time you can minister, witness, give outreach is when you in a three-piece suit. When you in your Sunday morning dress. How many of you know that God will use you in your slippers with rollers in your head, bad breath and all, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ? Because this word is so powerful, it'll work through any vessel. This word is so powerful, it'll work through any clothing accessory. And all you got to do is be willing to share what God has given you. I'm almost through. Whew, y'all still with me? Not only do we need to stop feeling good, not only do we need to stop looking good, here you go. Stop being Jesus' PR person. Jesus does not need a public relations official. Help me up in here. He does not need someone to work on his public perception. And you so worried trying to fix up the public perception of Christ that you don't understand that the power of Christ is at the cross. I don't know about you. There's nothing pretty about the cross. There's nothing to feel good about the cross. The cross is an ugly story. And a crossless story is a powerless faith. I know some of y'all walking around here with your big old cross around your neck, your big old Bible in your hand, trying to look holy. Ain't talking to half the folks in church. Hello, somebody. I know you got your handkerchief on like you're all holy, rolling your eyes at the other half of the church. But real outreach is not how you look, it's not how you sound, it's not how you feel. Real outreach is saying, Lord, I'm a vessel to be used by you. Any way you want to use me, anywhere you want to use me, anyhow you want to use me, just use me. Y'all still here? The PR person for the Stars takes their negative behavior and tries to spin it. The PR person tries to make the individual famous. Y'all still with me? Let me help you out. Put this in your notes. Jesus does not want to be famous. Jesus wants to be known. Let me. Y'all gonna make me shout by myself. Stop trying to make him famous and make him known. You want everybody to know about him, but Jesus says, I want everybody to know me. Don't know about me, know me. You can know about him and still go to hell, but if you know him, you are saved until the day of redemption if you know him. Oh. I'm telling you, I'm done preaching. That was all I had for you this morning. If you didn't get it, you ain't gonna get it. You need to quit trying to make him famous and start making him known. That means that ministry and outreach may not go out on Monday and the person gets saved on the same day. It may mean that you gotta wait on him. Wait until the Lord does a work in their life to get them to turn from their wicked ways. How long am I gonna wait? I'm gonna wait until. I'm gonna love until. I'm gonna pray until. I'm gonna worship until. I'm gonna praise until. Until God changes the heart. But I'm not trying to make him popular. I'm not trying to do all that. I'm trying to make him known. You are a sorry instrument in God's arsenal because you're the only bullet that I've ever known to be shot from a gun but still look back at the gun. Stay there till you get it. Every other bullet, when it is shot from the gun, keeps going to the target. Hello, somebody. And it will stay in that target if it hits some hard. Stay with me. When I go out to witness and I come up to somebody that's got a hard heart, I don't go around them. I stay right there and keep on witnessing and keep on sharing until what was hard gets off. It may not happen in the first year. In fact, it may not happen in the first year because the first year might be you making up for all the hell you done did to them. Preach up in here, Davis. You see, if you didn't told me how bad I was, how sorry I was, how I wasn't going to never be nobody, and then you come to church and get a word from the Lord, and you come back and tell me that God loves me, I first got to reconcile. How can God love me and you don't even love me? So I gotta first spend some time cleaning up the mess. I gotta clean up what I messed up. Starting my life over again. Some of y'all gotta clean up the messed up relationship. Start it all over again. Before I tell you how much God loves you, let me first apologize for all the hate I gave on you. And then let me tell you, I love you. And how do I love you in spite of everything you've done? Because he first loved me. Come on and stay with me. And so outreach is about him. Paul says that I may know him. Let me help you out. Paul knew about him already. He was crucifying the church, persecuting the church, because he knew about him. But when he met him on the Damascus Road, he went from knowing about him to knowing him. You will never have the power of God talking about what you know about. It only comes from what you know of. I don't know about him being a healer. I know him as a healer. You out there still talking about what mama said. You out there talking about what David said. What the deacon said. And God is looking down at you and saying, I sent you out there so that you can tell them your story. For you to tell them your story, you got to first know him for yourself. And then you got to be okay that he loves you and has redeemed you. See, that's the problem. That's the problem. Let me put a pin right there. Most of us won't do outreach because we really don't know if we saved. Just look back at me. Don't put your head down there. I know I'm talking about you. Most of us won't do outreach because we're still struggling if we've been forgiven. It's hard to tell CJ, God forgives you, and I'm walking around here looking over my shoulder wondering, did he forgive me? The message is not authentic. And so some of us are given a sorry copycat message. No, God will forgive you, I think. Pookie and Ray Ray and Junebug and Bit, they not going to come to Jesus if they think he might forgive them. Why would I come to a God that might forgive me when Herb forgives me all the way? Don't act like you don't know what Herb is. How am I going to come to God that might forgive me when this Jack Daniel forgives me all the way? All I got to do is keep drinking enough. If I drink enough, it'll forgive me. But it don't forget. Y'all do realize that. Jack Daniels will forgive, but it won't forget. Wake up tomorrow after it's forgotten or it forgave you. It'll remind you that you drunk too much the night before. But if you come to God, God will forgive you totally and forget about what he forgave you of. Oh, I feel good right there. And tomorrow when you wake up, he will not remind you that you got too much of him the day before. In fact, he'll give you more on Tuesday than you got on Monday. And give you more on Wednesday than you got on Tuesday. He'll give you more. I want us to be a church of outreach. I am tired of us being happy going to heaven, just us. Because if we're happy going to heaven, just us, we gonna get to heaven and find out we got blood on our hands for everybody we were supposed to help get in the kingdom that we didn't help. Well, Reverend, listen. Let me tell you right here, Reverend. I'm saved. My wife's saved. My three children saved. That's enough. That's enough. We gonna come to church every Sunday, Reverend. We gonna tithe. We gonna come to enrichment hour. We gonna come to Wednesday night. If you got a 3 o'clock service, Reverend, we gonna be there. But that's all that we gonna bring to heaven is me and my dependents. And then one day you and your dependents are gonna die. And you're going to stand before the judgment bar. And God going to ask you, did you bring me any fruit? Y'all don't mind if I can temporize this text. Eh? Did you bring me any fruit? Lord, I brought my dependents. He said, I know you brought them, but did you bring me any fruits? You do know I like pineapple. You do know I like some citrus. You do know I like grapes. You do know I like bananas. Did you bring me any fruits? I ain't got nobody but me and my descendants. And that's when we gonna find out. Reverend, I didn't know I was supposed to save grapes. See, fruit is folks. Fruits. When he said, did you bring me any fruit? What God is saying is, did you bring me anybody? I know you in my family. Did you bring me anybody else to join my family? Not just your dependents, but there's some Pookies, some Ray Rays, some Bitbits, some Kikis, some whatevers. They're all out there waiting on you. Did you bring? See? Some of y'all are so used to coming to the family reunion and the family dinners and not bringing nothing but an empty pan to take stuff home. Preach up in here, Davis. Some of y'all are so used to coming to the family gathering and you ain't brought nothing but that plastic Ziploc bag in your purse so you can put the scraps in there. Some of y'all are so used to come into the family gathering and not bringing anything that you think when we get up to that great getting up morning, you can go to God's reunion and not bring anything. And the devil is a liar. You gotta bring some fruit to the table. The table is so big, but there's some empty seats at the table. And God said, I completed the work on the cross. And now I gave you the ministry of invitation. See, some of y'all been selling dinners too long. Chicken dinners. $12, Deacon Marks. Get a leg and a thigh, macaroni and cheese and some green beans, and a piece of cake, and a Shasta for $12. Call in orders, welcome. We will deliver. And God said, I don't need you selling no chicken dinners. What I want you to do is give away this. Give away Jesus. Don't sell Jesus. Give him away. I didn't come for nothing else but to give you Jesus. And if I give you Jesus, I'm invite you to the table to have a seat at the table. The real goal of outreach you ain't got to sell it, you ain't got to browbeat nobody. You ain't got to guilt nobody into this. You ain't got to talk about, you better do it before it's too late. Too late might be tomorrow. Let me help you out with that word. Jesus does not even know when he's coming back. Go look at the scripture. He says, I don't even know when, but when my Father sends me back, That's when I'm coming back. So if Jesus don't know when he's coming back, why you think you know? You better come today. You might be tomorrow, might be too late. Guess what? Tomorrow might be too late for you. If you got that word, you need to get right. Real outreach is about me loving you enough that I'm going to stay here until the change happens. I'm going to hold you during the change. I'm going to shout with you. When you give your life to him, I'm going to cry with you. When you go through your addiction withdrawal, so help me somebody. Because real outreach is not just about me giving you the invitation and giving you the word. Real outreach is about me now walking with you to get closer to him. Lean over to your neighbor and say, boy, David's preaching today. Davis is preaching today. Davis is preaching today. Because if I go to heaven and I don't bring no fruit, I might find that my seat has been removed. Because the word does talk about, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. That means they was doing something, but they weren't doing the right something. I'd hate to come to church, come to Bible school, come to everything else, and be a worker of iniquity because I brought no fruit. I'm gonna love you enough that I'm gonna wait. I don't know how long I'm gonna wait. I'm just gonna wait. I'm gonna love you enough that I'm not gonna count you out because you didn't come to my church the first time I invited you. I'm not gonna kick you out because you mess up one time. I'm gonna love you enough. I'm just gonna wait. Because I know there's a season for everything. And I know God wouldn't send me here for my outreach assignment if he didn't plan on you coming to him. So I'm just gonna wait until you and him work this thing out. I'm just gonna keep loving you. And when we keep loving folks, we'll see them come to him. I don't know a whole lot of y'all who got invited to Jesus one time and you came that time. Most of us, let's be honest, most of us, amen. Most of us, we had to have multiple invitations. Multiple. Most of us had to have somebody explain it to us multiple ways. Some of us didn't get John 3:16 straight from the King James Version. Some of us had to go through the Hard Knocks Version. Some of us didn't come to Jesus weary, wounded, and sad. Some of us came to Jesus high, drunk. Stay here with me. Some of us didn't come to Jesus with our hand lifted up. Some of us came to Jesus with tears in our eyes, saying, Lord, I done tried everything else. Please save me. Some of us didn't ask the Lord, just come in my heart. Some of us begged him to come in because we didn't try everything else. And it don't matter how you come to him, just come to him. Just come to him. I don't care how. I don't care what you look like. Just come to him. Why? Because there's healing for your soul in him. There's deliverance for your soul. Y'all, come on, as we get ready for the invitation. Somebody in here, the word was speaking to you. Somebody, the Lord is saying, it's your day.